spice. I feel nice like sugar and spice.
Fantastic day. So of course, as always, you know, I like to get started and kind of go over what we are going to be covering today. So first things first, as we go through the weekly industry update today, we are going to be looking at a review of where the month ended for May. So the May data is out. We are going to be taking a look at that this week. And then of course, we'll look at where we are month to date, but I really want you to pay attention to some of the month over month that we look at today. We're also going to be talking a little bit about foreclosures, right? There's going to be, there's a lot of news pieces, articles that are coming out right now, talking about the increase recently. Let me fix this for the lighting. One second, you guys. Let me close that. There we go. Okay. That is talking a lot about how we are starting to see some additional foreclosure starts that have been happening over the last couple months. And so I want to talk about that. I also want to put it in perspective of what that looks like in comparison to what it's looked like in the past. I think it's always important that we inspect what we expect and that we have a little bit more understanding of what we're actually seeing out on the news. With that being said, there's two things that I want to, well, of course, our TCPA is going to be important for us to take a look at as well. You know, just make sure that whatever we talk about today, you use it in a TCPA compliant way. But with that being said, last week, we had a lot of opportunity to talk about, Pride Month. And so we went into some statistics specific to Pride and our LGBTQ plus community. Today, I actually wanted to talk about Juneteenth. So Monday, this coming Monday, the 19th, our office will be closed. And so I wanted to share with you some statistics that I think are important for you to have an understanding about why we do close our offices in observance of Juneteenth. Juneteenth is not the day of, how do I put it? It's not the day that, you know, slavery was designated as hey, this is when it's going to be over. That happened before. But this is the day, June 19th in 1965, when the last of the slaves were freed in Galveston, Texas. And so I think that's part of the reason why it's important for us to celebrate Juneteenth. That happened in 1965. It's not historic because of Black Americans being declared free. That actually happened 2 years prior to Juneteenth. But it's historic because it is the last day that slaves were actually freed. And so it's just a time for assessment, a time for self-improvement and planning for the future. It's important to kind of look at how we acknowledge this time period of history, but how we also acknowledge how this has impacted our history in real estate throughout the years as well. Because I think a couple of the things that are really important to understand is that it wasn't until then, 1968. So this is 1865, right? When Juneteenth happened, it wasn't until almost more than 100 years later that the Fair Housing Act came into effect that allowed Black Americans to own land and become and not be discriminated against on the basis of race. And so that's an important piece to kind of know about the history of, you know, just of our community. And that happened. There had been multiple years since the Civil Rights Act in 1964, where lawmakers couldn't agree on fair housing legislation across the state. That didn't happen until 1968 in the wake of Dr. Martin Luther King's assassination. So just important for us to have an understanding of as well, because it impacts, again, a lot within our history. And so I wanted to share that as we get started. And so you know why we will be closed this coming Monday, June 19th. All right. So coming on in to Los Angeles County, let's take a look at where things ended up in May. So again, we're going to spend a lot more time today on the May to April, our kind of trends. I do want you to look at this in retrospect, right? Look over the last few months so that we can have a little bit of that understanding here. We've been seeing the number of properties available for sale in Los Angeles County. The height, right? We saw a height here in July, and then we saw a couple declines. We saw a little bit of an increase here in October. And since October, we've seen this go down. We are seeing a slight increase this month of 1.5%. Again, this is a little different than what we typically see during this time of the year. If you look at March, April, May, June, July, we saw significant increases. Here, we're seeing a 1.5% increase, so a very small increase here. And yet, that increase is occurring as late as May, right? As late as May. So it's almost as though we have a delayed seasonality that is occurring here in terms of the number of properties for sale. Again, this is also kind of married to some of the issues that we're having from an inventory perspective. And so we are going to talk about that. When we look at the number of properties sold, we had seen some downward fluctuation. We saw an increase here in the month of March. We saw a decline in April, and we've seen a little bit of that recovery happen in the month of May. So that went up 19.3% in the month of May. Of course, this is in both cases, we are down significantly from where we were a year ago. That was to be anticipated. We anticipated that 2023, there was going to be less sales, less properties available. The market as a whole was going to be a bit lower than what it was in 2022, which is considered with 2020, 2021, kind of a height of the market year. And so these numbers are to be anticipated. Whereas these numbers here, month over month, is a little bit more of that delayed kind of seasonality that we're experiencing. With that being said, month to date, we're experiencing another decline here in the number of properties for sale, down 3.1%, and the number of properties sold month to date in the month of June, down 21.1%. So starting to kind of see those continued declines. When we look at our inventory trends, one thing that was very significant going from April to May was that we saw an increase in both the number of new listings that came on the market, up 6.4%, and the number of properties pending, up 12%. Not as significant an increase as we saw last year during this same time frame, where we actually started to see, if you look at this, right, May at April to May, we started to see this is a little bit of a plateau here. And then April to May here in the number of new listings, we did see a bit of an increase. So lower than it was a year ago, but we are seeing increases in both categories here. And yet month to date so far in the month of June, from the 1st through the 11th of the month, we are seeing a 26.4% decline in the number of new listings, and pendings are down 24.3%. So again, not typical of what we normally see from a seasonality perspective. What about our prices, right? What about our prices? When we look at that average active price, up 1.8%, and the average sold price is nearing it, up 1.8% from May to April. I always think when we look at prices, it's so interesting to see how advertised price fluctuates so much while that sold price stays fairly consistent, right? I think it's definitely a testament to how we as agents think when we are pricing out property and how we look at the market. It's also a testament a lot of times into how sellers think, right? They start seeing an inflation of advertised price and they're more attached to that than what somebody sells at. They're always delayed based on what they're seeing on the news and some of their emotion they have around the value of their home, even though the actual sold prices stay, while not completely consistent, stay a little bit more uniform across the board. This kind of increase that we're seeing, right? We've seen at these continued increases the month before. So you can see from March to April, all the way back since about January, we've seen the advertised prices go up. And yet there's some spread down here when we look at what the properties are actually selling at. When we look at where we are month to date, that advertised price has continued to rise. So that average active price up 3.3%. And yet the average sold price seen a smaller decline, a smaller incline here of 1.4%. Down significantly from where we were a year ago here, right? Down 12.2% from a year ago. We look at our months of inventory. So as I mentioned, when we looked at this before, you know, that what we've been seeing in the market has been a decline here of the available inventory. From April to May, we see that decline of 16.2%. At just a little over 1.5 months of inventory, we are still very heavily in a quote unquote seller's market. We have been for over a decade now. I mean, this is so, which is why it's so important to kind of inspect that a little bit more. We can't just say, hey, you know, buyer's market or seller's market, this is when it makes the most sense for somebody to buy or somebody to sell. There's a lot more to it than that, right? I think that when we think about buyer's market and seller's market and balanced market, it can be a little simplistic because of that. We know that a quote unquote seller's market is between 1 to 5 months of inventory, balanced market being between 5 to 7 months of inventory, and a seller's market being about 7+ months of inventory. Does not mean that it is not a great time for a buyer to buy. We are anticipating, there's been talk that with the Fed meeting coming up, we may see, I'm hearing this from some people that I know in banking world, that we may see one more small increase. We'll see, right? But we know that that then eliminates some of the demand that we have for the inventory that is available. It also takes sellers out of the market because they're also the majority of the time, about over 55% of the time, they are also buying, right? And so that's just important for us to know. Where we are month to date, we see a slight increase in the inventory here, up 24%, slight in that it's still significantly less than 5 months of inventory, but large considering where we're at, right? 24%, almost a quarter of an increase in available inventory month to date. And then last but not least for Los Angeles County, our days on market, continuing to see a decline from April to May, down to 32 days on market, down 8.6%. And then this sold versus original list price going up 1%. Remember that active price is also rising, right? So that active price is also going up, that advertised price, and yet sold versus original list, we're seeing we're still under that 100% mark at 99% of original list price. Where we are month to date, there's no change here, but a continued decline in days on market. So again, the less inventory we have, the higher the demand that we have, the quicker homes sell, which is why we're starting to see again that increase in the average days on market. All right, moving on over to Orange County, my friends. Number of properties for sale from April to May, up 2.8%. Number of properties sold up 20.1%. That's a big increase here month over month. We look at this information here, right? Where we were seeing the number of properties for sale rise during this period of time last year. This is a very slight increase, right? 2.8% is not a big increase in the number of properties for sale. in comparison to what we saw a year ago. The difference being that we saw declines here in the number of properties sold. We're actually seeing those increases happen, up 20.1%. So we'll continue to monitor this, but I want you to see how it's very juxtaposed to what we saw a year ago in this same market. We're not experiencing the same market, right? We're not experiencing normal seasonality right now. This is very atypical. In reality, the last few years have been like that. Ever since the pandemic, we haven't necessarily gotten back to normal seasonality in every market, right? And so just important to kind of take a look at here. Where we are month to date, number of properties available for sale continuing to rise. And yet the number of properties sold thus far month to date, down 30.6%. That is a big decrease. However, number of properties sold, we really don't see that until the end of the month. We generally see that also tick up at the end of the month, because what happens? Everybody's trying to get their escrows closed in time for the new month. We see that a lot. So this number, anytime we look at one of these numbers that is a little bit more of a lag measure, end of month is going to be the best data for us there. What about new listings, right? From April to May in Orange County, slight decline. That's fairly balanced here. We saw a year ago, right? We saw a slight increase here, but we were much higher in terms of the amount of available listings. And then when we look at properties pending, up 5.2%. So we're seeing a continued increase here, where April to May, we saw a slight increase here as well before we started to see a decline in the number of properties pending. So we'll continue to kind of watch this. Month to date, new listings down 41.4% from May to June, right? So looking at May to June, and then the number of properties pending down 12.9% month to date. So we continue to watch this. Again, there may be listings that, let's say, people captured over the weekend that will go into effect now, but that is still a fairly big decline thus far in the month through the 11th. We look at our average active price. So similar to what we saw in LA County, average active price is experiencing an increase. However, the average sold price is not. So in LA, we saw both of these kind of experience a little bit of an increase here. When we look at this market, unfortunately, the active price in the market is not following what is actually happening with property sales, where we're seeing a decline in that average sold price. This may mean we have a higher spread here if properties are selling less than that kind of advertised value. Where we are month to date, starting to see that decline there, right, of that average active price. So it's kind of lagging based on what we're seeing the month prior. And then that average sold price this month experiencing an increase through the 1st through the 11th of the month here. This is a good number to look at, right? This is also up 4% from where we were a year ago. So if we look at that from last month, right, May 22 to May 23, we see a decline here of 5.7%. Thus far, month to date, a little bit of an increase. We'll see where this ends up at the end of the month. And then our absorption rate. Months of inventory, slight decrease here. We are still very, very low on inventory numbers, right? And last week, when we went over that and I showed you guys data from 2019, right, from 2021, from 2022, so that you could see some of that, you can see where from an inventory perspective, our inventory is significantly lower than it was even in 2019, where we were already talking about some of these inventory challenges. The biggest difference between 2019 and now is that we have less demand, right? But not in relation to the available inventory, right? So in 2019, we had what we considered then low inventory and high demand. Well, right now, even though demand is significantly lower than it was in 2019, the inventory is matching that, which is why we're still seeing that kind of supply and demand issue. The amount of demand is still outweighing the amount of available inventory on the market. this absorption number, right? The absorption number relates to the current number of sales in relation to the current amount of inventory that's available. So in 2019, we could have had 3, 4, 5 times the amount of inventory that's available right now. And yet the absorption rates were very similar to what we're seeing because, again, there was much more demand. And so it matched it with that available inventory. We are still in a very low inventory market. Your clients are seeing this when you're putting in offers and you're still competing on multiple offer scenarios. That's where this is going to show up. When we look at where we are month to date, a slight increase here in months of inventory, that's an increase of 64.3%. A big increase in relation to the amount of available inventory, but not a big increase in relation to the overarching demand that we currently have in the market. And then last but not least, our days on market, continuing to see a decline here. This is in relation to the demand that we're seeing on the market. And then that sold versus original list price continuing to get pushed up. This is up 1% at 98% of original list price. So we're still seeing some negotiation that's happening throughout. A lot of times this is going to be credits on repairs and things like that that we're seeing through escrow. What we are seeing is a little bit of a trend, right? Is properties that are getting into escrow and then throughout that, throughout the negotiations, something happens with the loan, right? Is maybe interest rate went up and they didn't lock a rate and now the payment is going to be a little bit too high and they can't swing it, right? And now you're at day 20, 24, you know, of escrow ready to sign, thinking if you're on the listing side that we're about ready to sign loan docs and now there's an issue. And so we've seen a lot of negotiation that's happening at the tail end of the transaction versus in the middle, which is where we tend to see, you know, repair requests, things that come from investigation. We're seeing a lot more negotiation that has to do with the loan. Even though in some of these cases, we may be in a multiple offer scenario, this sold versus original list price, seeing that little bit of a decline below when we're in multiple offers is because of some of that negotiation that occurs at the tail end of the transaction, right? When the seller says, you know what, I'd rather negotiate and pay to play, pay to close the deal than not, then fall out of escrow and start this whole thing again, right? And so that's where we're seeing this sold versus the original list price not hit above 100% right now, even though we're still seeing multiple offer situations. And then where we are so far month to date, a bigger decline here on the average days on market in Orange County. And then that sold versus original list price, seeing a significant decline thus far month to date, down 4.1%. All right, looking at Riverside County, number of properties available for sale, continuing to see a decline that is not in alignment with what we would traditionally see this time of year, down 2.2%. Number of properties sold, however, seeing an increase here at 15.6%. Both down from where we were a year ago. We look at the number of properties for sale month to date, slight increase here at 2.4%, and then sold down 27.9%. We look at our new listings coming on the market. This is a market where from April to May, we saw an increase. So we get into our lower priced counties, seeing an increase here of 5.4%, and then pendants up 15.3%. So kind of continuing to see that increase here. You'll notice the pendants has been going up faster than the number of listings available in Riverside County. This is going to speak to demand, right, in Riverside County. Affordability becomes an issue. When affordability becomes an issue, demand increases in lower price point areas. And we can see that with the pendants going up here as well. And yet, month to date, seeing a decline in the number of new listings, down 38.2%, and pendants down 18.5%. A little bit more of a spread here. The pendants is still higher, not the decrease is higher, but the number of pendants that are happening is still higher than the number of listings coming on the market. We look at the active price, down 0.1% here. And that average sold price month over month from April to May up 1.2%. It was down from a year ago, down 1.7%. So it's not the same price as somebody was getting a year ago, but still a little bit higher than they would get last month. We look at their average active price and sold price month to date. We're seeing that decline here from the 1st to the 11th, active price down 2.4%, and this average sold price down 6.5%. Our absorption rates, so kind of what we've been seeing, a little bit of a decline here. Again, now we're seeing differences in every market, right? The higher the market, the more we see an inventory climb a little bit. Here we look from April to May, we're in a lower price point county, and we are seeing that demand increase. That also gives us a little bit of that decline in terms of the amount here of available inventory. When we look at where we are month to date, so month to date, this is showing us a big increase, up 51.7%. This is important to watch where we end the month, right? Where we end the month, because we have new inventory that comes on the market. We have pendants that go in. We have all these different things that are happening at the same time. And it can skew the numbers just a little bit, especially when we have less listings that are coming on the market. And when we look at weekend data, it's not always taking that into account. So I always say these kind of where we are month to date, take it with a grain of salt, inspect it a little bit more, ask some questions about that data. Okay, average days on market, down 8.2%. This is the longest for all the counties thus far in terms of days on market. The other ones were almost below 30 days, like 27 days. Just take that into consideration. And then sold versus original list price, also saw a slight increase here. We're at 97% of original list price in the month of May. But where we are month to date, seeing a slight decline on average days on market still, going down to 38 days on market. And then this sold versus original list price down to 93%, right? So there's more of a spread here when we look at Riverside County. Okay, looking at our last county, right? Our last county, we're going to talk through the properties for sale. So San Bernardino County, this is our lowest price point county. Number of properties for sale seen an increase here, up 5.9%, and number of properties sold up 16.8%. So an increase in both categories here. We saw declines in the number of properties sold a year ago during this time, and we're seeing that increase here. When we look at where we are month to date, number of properties for sale continuing to see an increase here at 10.3%, while the number of properties sold has declined down 24.3%. When we look at our inventory trends, new listings, an increase from April to May, up 10% in San Bernardino County. So we're seeing more inventory coming on the market here. And then pendants also up 10.7%. I want you to look at what April to May looked like a year ago, right? New listings saw a bigger increase, and the number of properties that were pendant saw a slight increase. Here we're kind of see both of these follow each other, right? A fairly significant increase, and these increases match each other here, right? So we are seeing more activity here. Where are we month to date, right? Month to date, starting to experience a dip, down 26.7% in terms of the number of new listings. We look at May to June a year ago, we start to see a little bit of that decline here. And then the same thing happens in terms of the number of properties for sale, right? Or that penned. So just take that into consideration, because in some ways we are not following kind of the traditional way that the market goes, right? We're not following a traditional seasonality where we tend to see more of an increase here in the second and third quarters of the month. This is about the point. If we think about this last year, I want you to know that when we look at last year's data, it's not very typical of traditional seasonality. Why? What happened around this time period that dictated that we started to see a decline in sales that happened like this, right? A decline in the number of new listings, a decline in the properties pended across the board. I just want you to think you know, think a little bit deeper on this is that this is about the time period last year where we saw interest rates start to rise, right? And so it takes time for the market to kind of find its bearings and correct itself, which is part of why we have such a skewed kind of seasonality. But it's just take it with a grain of salt when we're looking at that data, right? Because it doesn't necessarily mean we're going to anticipate the same thing we saw a year ago, because we're not seeing such a aggressive approach with the interest rates anymore, right? Yes, we may experience another increase, but before we were experiencing increase, right? It was a lot different. So just take that into consideration. Average active price from April to May up 2.9%. So see these increases here and the spread down here where we're seeing that average sold price continue to go down. These are really not following each other. They're kind of going in the opposite direction in both of these. And then where we are month to date, slight increase again in active price, but starting to see that average sold price come back to follow this active price here as well, right? Up 5.4%. Looking at our absorption rates, we saw a decline of 10% from April to May, putting us about 1.8 months of inventory, still not a lot. And then an increase thus far month to date, up 51.6%, up to 2.6 months of inventory, still does not move us out of a quote unquote seller's market. And then last but not least for San Bernardino County, no change in average days on market, no change in sold versus original list price from April to May. So that stayed stagnant. However, it's important for us to know that the average active price and the average sold price did not, right? So this doesn't take into account that change in the spread. And then where we are month to date, that days on market continuing to decline. We've seen this across all four counties at this point. And then that sold versus original list price, we're seeing a more of a decline here, down 2%. So a lot of information there. So we went over the information on Juneteenth. We went over our market data. Now I want to make sure that we talk a little bit about foreclosures, right? Foreclosures. So I wanted to go over this because there's a lot of reports out right now. ATTOM is one of the curators of real estate data, right? So they collect real estate data. They released their May 2023 U.S. foreclosure report. And what they saw is that there was a total of 35,196 U.S. properties with foreclosure filings. This is going to be meaning when we talk foreclosure filings. Now, there's going to be two different data points that you think about when we think about U.S. foreclosure activity. There's a foreclosure filing, which is default notice, scheduled auction, or bank repossession filing. And then there's actual so these are foreclosure starts, meaning that the foreclosure process is started. And then there's actual foreclosure completions, and that's different, right? That means that the default notice, okay, they got the notice, and then they were actually foreclosed on, right? There was a scheduled auction, and then it actually got auctioned off. Not, hey, there was a scheduled auction, but they were able to take care of the issue before the auction actually happened, right? So that's important. This is up 7% from last month, right? So this is up 7% from a month ago, and up 14% from a year ago. Now, this is something, a couple things that happened. So there's three states, Illinois, Maryland, and New Jersey, that have the highest foreclosure rates right now, right? And yet the greatest number of foreclosure starts, meaning that that these are the notice of default, right? The auction notices, et cetera, is Florida, California, and Texas. In California, last month, we had 2,451 foreclosure starts. So one of the highest foreclosure starts, right? And yet, I want you to put that in perspective, right? 2,400 foreclosure starts in the entire state, right? The entire state of California. That's important to kind of have an understanding of, is that when we see this again, foreclosure starts and foreclosure completions is different. Now, the foreclosure completion numbers across the United States was up 38%, right? Lenders repossessed. So I'm going to put this in perspective. Okay. 4,020 U.S. properties nationwide. 4,020 U.S. properties nationwide. So the reason that I want to share some of those numbers, and that was up 38% from a month ago, that was up 41% from a year ago. The reason that I want to put this in perspective is that, yes, we are seeing a higher number of foreclosures. That is a listing opportunity. When we look at foreclosure starts, you're talking your NODs, your pre-auction, your pre-foreclosure. That is absolutely a listing opportunity. What I don't want you to get confused with, however, is that it is not the same. It is not the same as what we saw in 2007, 2008. So when we think about this as a lead generation activity, there is opportunity that exists, but it's going to be an arm of your lead generation strategy, not the only arm of your lead generation strategy. Because when we look at this data, this is geared to put it in perspective of what this actually looked like if we're comparing where we are now, Q1 of 2023, where we are experiencing some spikes here. And yet, when I shared these numbers, I said that, hey, you know, in Q1 of 2023, the total U.S. foreclosures that started the foreclosure process in quarter one, so here in Q1 of 2023, is 65,346, less than 100,000 in the entire United States, right? When we were at the height of the foreclosure market up here, we saw that was a little less, between 500,000 to 600,000 in the entire United States. And so it's just always important to us for us to understand this, but also look at how it's different, right? You'll notice in 2020, obviously during the forbearance, right? This is the forbearance market. We saw a major decline. This is almost as though we're returning to a little bit more normal, right? More normalized foreclosure starts. That was pretty typical. From, we look at this, we kind of hit this 100,000 mark in 2016 and held that steady until about 2020, right? Where it was just below that 100,000 mark before we saw a big decline. So I just want to share this because I do think that it's important to recognize that there is an opportunity that exists if this is a market that you're going to focus on. But whether you were in the market back in 2007, 2008, and you're like, hey, I think this opportunity is the same. It's not the same, right? Or if you're just hearing a lot of people talking about that, because that I've seen some posts, I've seen some things about that. I've seen a lot of people selling programs on like becoming an REO agent and things like that as well. And the truth is there's simply not enough for that to be viable as your only source of business, right? It definitely should be an arm of your business if you are going to focus on NODs for listings or those pieces as well. But it should not be the only arm of your business because there's not going to be enough inventory to support it. Now, might we see more inventory loosen up as these numbers go up? Are they anticipating that this rises? I would say yes, right? We are going to be in a very... We're in a very different market right now, right? We have experienced a major decline in the number of foreclosures that happen because of the kind of moratoriums that we saw. And so that inventory has to get shaken up and released if they were already supposed to have a foreclosure. And now, okay, here we are. Why are we having more foreclosure starts than we're having foreclosure completions? That has a lot to do with the equity that exists in the market. So there's a lot of people that are able to then use that equity to stop from going into foreclosure process, which is another piece or kind of another layer on top of this information. Now, there may be a couple different things that happen. You have a lot of people that over the course of the last 2 years, right, had changes in where they lived because their jobs went remote. Some of the things that I've been hearing with certain companies, you have certain companies that are doing mass layoffs, right? Now this is not our, US unemployment rate is still fairly normal, right? It's still fairly normal. It's not significantly high. And yet, as we go into quote unquote recessionary environment, might it be that we see more layoffs, which means that more people need to access the home, right? The value that they have in their home or aren't able to make payments. That is a possibility. You're also seeing some places that had gone quote unquote what they thought would be permanent remote and are now going hybrid remote. So I've seen that happen where people's schedules have changed from being fully remote to being, okay, it's 3 days remote and then 2 days at office, right? And so that kind of changes up where people are living and what that looks like, especially if they moved quite a distance, then there's some job changes or potential for loosening of inventory there. We will have some foreclosures. I do anticipate this going higher. Now, do I anticipate it going here? There's no way for us to know that, but as of right now, it does not seem likely that we would get as high as we did in 2007, 2008. So it's important because we do need additional inventory. But I did want to just kind of put this in perspective with a lot of the different information that's out there right now. With that being said, my friends, of course, you know, I'm going to continue to talk about Ignite week after week. I would note, whether you are an experienced agent or not, I highly recommend attending the Ignite sessions. When we go into an environment like the one we're in now, right, the market gets shaken up a little bit, going back to basics and doing activities every single day is incredibly important for our business. And that is what Ignite is designed to do. We've had some phenomenal instructors. I know this week you guys were talking about social media lead generation with Brandy. There's going to be some sections on listings that are coming up. I know Ramona's teaching a session. I know Shelly's teaching a session. We've had Jen teach a session. Diana, James is going to be teaching a session. Martha's teaching a session. This is a great opportunity to really see not only the formula for the business, but how some of our top producers are using that in their business and their own best practices as well. So definitely make sure you are attending Ignite. You get a chance to hear from a lot of different instructors on how they do business. And then I shared this before and I shared this again. I hope all of you had a chance to be on last week's session where I not only went over the mortgage hacks and the mortgage hacks email, but I went over the mortgage calculator, right? So that you can also present to your clients and understand the differences between doing a rate buy down and doing a price deduction, and realize that sometimes doing a rate buy down is a better value to your clients than doing a price reduction, right? And so when we have that understanding, we can structure deals in a way that is going to be most valuable to them. I highly recommend you check that out, my friends. With that, I know that was a lot of information today. I hope that you found that valuable. Again, as a reminder, as I mentioned at the beginning, you know, and in celebration of Juneteenth, we will be closed on Monday. So I wanted to note that off the bat. And I'm glad I got a chance to share a little bit of the history of both Juneteenth and some of what we see in fair housing and NAR. I think it's important for us to not just celebrate these holidays as they come up, but to have an understanding, right, of how they impact us in our industry. But with that being said, as always, if you need to access the office on holiday or Sunday, please come out and check out a card. Anytime we don't have security in the front, you just need to check out a card here from the front desk. With that, I hope you have an amazing, amazing rest of your day, and I will see you all soon. Bye, everyone.